Good evening, everyone. We are going to continue from where we stopped in our part one of internal medicine, and I want to appreciate everyone for the encouragement. So I try to make the explanations very as brief as possible so that I can have as much questions as possible within a 15 minutes video. So in this particular patient, you will discover that this is a cardiovascular patient, and these presentations will be similar, but you should just watch out for certain additional information. For example, in this 67-year-old patient, you will notice that the ventricular complexes are widened, so that they are talking about the QRS in this condition. Anytime you notice that the QRS is widened or deformed, it means that the process is occurring inside the ventricle. So we are left with ventricular extrasystole or paroxysmal ventricular tachycardia. So looking at the fact that there is no conformity between the P and the QRS, and the pulse is 200, that leaves us to our best possible answer of paroxysmal ventricular tachycardia. Next, this is a 30-year-old patient, and by the growing fingers and facial score, you notice that it means that there's disproportionate growth in the patient. The person is growing abnormally, so you are thinking of something that has to do with growth hormone. And so anytime you see a question that is pointing your attention to the cellular tosica, so from our anatomy, cellular tosica is like the region where the pituitary gland sits, and since we also have factors showing that there's excessive growth and so on and so forth, you think of growth hormone, and that is simply adenoma of hypophysis. Every other thing is explained here, it's just good for us, but the best thing to look out for is the broadening of the cellular tosica. So that's adenoma of hypophysis. Hypophysis is still like a pituitary gland. Here we have a patient that produces about 600 ml of purulent chocolate sputum. One thing I like about chocolate is that it always reminds me of gangrene. So I mean medical chocolate. So whenever you see a chocolate colored sputum, think of gangrene of the lungs, like very like commonly. So you can see other chocolate factors, 600 ml, that is a lot. You may not have that in bronchiectasis. In severe conditions of bronchiectasis, you can have more than 150 ml. But in this condition of such a large amount together with chocolate colored sputum, so think of gangrene of lungs. Here, this is a patient with kidney disorder, and the best thing to notice as you observe this question that the patient had acute nephritis 10 years ago. So whatever it is that the patient is having right now, with all this urine analysis, is going to be relating to the kidney. Whenever they are telling you Krok about urine analysis, most of the time watch out for the kidney. So here we have albumin 0.9, and this is the reason why it is not nephrotic syndrome. In nephrotic syndrome, we have proteins or albumin greater than 3.0, in some texts 3.5 grams per liter. So this will have nephrotic syndrome. So in this patient, our next best answer is chronic nephritis with violation of kidney function. It's not this, because this is simple hypertension, and here we have a renal disorder. Studies of kidney artery, they are going to give us information on examination of the renal arteries, pheochromocytoma. No, it just causes malignant hypertension, which is periodical. So the best answer is chronic nephritis with violation of kidney function. Also, in addition, I need to mention that one of the ways to remember that nephrotic syndrome is majorly a protein losing condition is from the name nephrotic, like fro, protein. That's how I remember it. Then definitely the other one has to do with blood, which is nephritic syndrome. So we have a 33-year-old patient here. You can see that the patient is beginning to get into shock from the blood pressure, and you can see the pulse, and the history is quite interesting. Suffered from ulcer of the stomach, which is painless, 4 years ago. So what can make an ulcer patient to start developing shock is simply one thing: the patient is bleeding from that particular ulcer. So it's simple, ulcer of stomach complicated with bleeding. Here we have a 48-year-old patient with right hypochondrium. With evidence in right hypochondrium, you are thinking of liver, you are thinking of gallbladder. But let's still consider some other things. Ishing as a result of bile acid products. Repeatedly icterus and itch, that icterus is jaundice. On physical examination, notice ascites, dilatation of abdominal wall veins, that is caput medusa. So when you see caput medusa and you're seeing ascites, without taking much of your time, just choose your answer to be liver cirrhosis. Here we have a 25-year-old patient with facial edema and back pains. You can notice the temperature and blood pressure is elevated. You have hematuria up to 100, that's so much. Proteinuria 2.0. And the patient actually had in history acute tonsillitis that started 2 weeks ago. So most of the time, acute tonsillitis is caused by group A streptococcus, and that can also cause some renal disorders. And the renal disorder caused in this condition is glomerulonephritis. But how are we going to know that it's not chronic and acute? See, the onset of disease is just within 2 weeks. So according to the period, this is acute glomerulonephritis. Glomerulonephritis is nephritic syndrome. Nephritic, that is, we have blood as well in the urine. Okay, I'm just going to differentiate these enzymes in case you find them in another question. We are giving majorly an anti-inflammatory drug, which is glucocorticoid in this particular case. So they are simply asking us, what is the mechanism of action? So cyclooxygenase 1-2 is going to be inhibited by NSAIDs, non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs. Glucocorticoid is going to inhibit phospholipase A2. So NSAID is for Cox. Glucocorticoid will inhibit phospholipase A2. Please don't forget. Also, this is history of a patient with rheumatoid arthritis. A patient with rheumatoid arthritis is going to point our attention according to the symptom that is being presented here. See, they are telling us that the patient has severe pain in the right hand, severe pain at night. And that pain is so severe that the patient needs to wake up from sleep. There's something that's very peculiar to severe pain at night in the wrist. That is carpal tunnel syndrome. One of the risk factors of carpal tunnel syndrome is rheumatoid arthritis. So when you see rheumatoid arthritis, severe pain in the hand at night, it is carpal tunnel syndrome. 19-year-old man has suffered from mental retardation since childhood. Patient is illiterate. You see, this is just, to me, this is not really a medical, this is just English question. What does his rehabilitation require? Look at all the options. Can take care of himself, household work, easy work supervision. The fact is, everything is in the options, all of the above. Okay, we have a 38-year-old patient. Sudden weakness, dizziness, loss of consciousness, weight loss, severe pain in the epigastrium, hyperpigmentation. This is the major thing in this condition. When you see hyperpigmentation, just know that there is a problem with the adrenal gland. The adrenal gland is not functioning, and because of that, we have excessive secretion of adrenocorticotropic hormone, which have effect on POMC, pro-opiomelanocortin, which will cause excessive skin pigmentation. So patients with such presentation together with hyperpigmentation, we present ourselves to Addison's disease or Addisonian crisis or Addisonian crisis, depending on, or chronic adrenal insufficiency, in case they change the answer in the exam. Here we have, this is a very good question, and I will just simply tell us how to differentiate the three. Patient is unconscious with moist skin. How do you know why the patient is in coma with moist skin and shallow breathing? So we need to know, and according to the history, previous injection on shoulder and hips, that is peculiar for a patient with diabetes mellitus. So tonus of skin, muscles, and reflexes are increase. So that this will point our attention to one thing. This is hypoglycemic coma, and I will tell us the reason. In hyperosmolar coma, never forget, please, the patient will be dehydrated, so don't expect something like moist skin. In hyperlactic acidotic coma, there's going to be something called Kussmaul breathing, and that is going to be deep breathing. So majorly, you are going to find the increase in skeletal muscle tone and reflexes together with moist skin and everything in hypoglycemic coma.